So this video is kind of a mix of old stuff and new stuff at the same time, because we're talking some more about Patrik Laine and the whole story that has been unfolding. We've been chronicling the Patrik Laine trade update scenario as things have come out from different people in the media. But we're highlighting this specific idea here today on the Patrik Laine story, mostly because of a conversation that occurred yesterday on That's Hockey on TSN. I'll leave a link in the description to the segment on TV where they spoke about this, but one of the biggest ideas that was brought up on yesterday's That's Hockey segment was the idea of the Winnipeg Jets not really having an easy time when it comes to trading Patrik Laine. Contrary to popular belief recently, where Pierre LeBrun noted how the Laine camp said that a trade would be mutually beneficial for both the team and for Laine themselves, contrary to what the fans believed after that, when they said, okay, it's a done deal, there's going to be a trade now, 110%, Pierre LeBrun came out on TV and he said, no, it's not that simple, because the idea that they were talking about in TSN yesterday was that Kevin Cheveldayoff is not going to make a Patrik Laine trade just to do it. He's going to make a Patrik Laine trade to make his roster better. He doesn't want to do a trade like this if his team is going to become worse on paper afterwards. So it becomes a lot more of a difficult decision to take a look at offers that would be made. And in fact, that's what this video is going to go over, because we had some word earlier on in the month as to what kind of offers could have actually been out there, and one in particular that apparently the Winnipeg Jets just did not think was sufficient. Let's go back over to the Elliotte Friedman 31 Thoughts podcast back from the beginning of the month. Here's a tweet from NHL Watcher on October 3rd, highlighting what exactly it is Friedman said on the podcast. He says that Carolina is indeed in on Patrik Laine, and he thinks the offer was Martin Necas and a defender. There was no name specified, however, Friedman says it's not a deal that Winnipeg really wanted to do. They preferred more. And I know what you're thinking. Okay, Martin Necas and a mid-tier D-man. I'm assuming it's a mid-tier D-man. It just says D-man on the tweet. It wasn't specified if there was any name. That's not a small amount of value there, I would say. I'm a big believer in Martin Necas as a guy. I honestly think the guy has elite potential. He's 21 years old. He was at a very good points per game in his rookie season in the NHL, potting up a very nice 36 points in 64 games played after totally taking over the Carolina Hurricanes AHL team. But if Kevin Cheveldayoff is in a spot where that guy, who is indeed very good, along with a defenseman that they could probably use on their lineup, is not enough for Patrik Laine, then my goodness, they really are trying to go for that we will absolutely win a trade if we trade Patrik Laine scenario. And I just don't know how possible that is to achieve. Take a look at this tweet over here. This is what Pierre LeBrun said on Overdrive a few days ago. The best player in the deal will be Laine. The Jets have to come to grips with that. They aren't getting an Ivan Provorov or a Jacob Slavin. So I think that's a very fair point to give out, because Patrik Laine is in a spot where, we noted this in the previous video as well, the Jets don't have any leverage when it comes to getting a Patrik Laine on the move. Any team that's out there is going to be the team that Laine gets dealt to, not the team that pried away Laine from Winnipeg. And we had another report by Pierre LeBrun earlier as well that noted apparently somewhat of a different direction of the Martin Necas front. Take a look at this over here. This is from NHL Rumours Daily. As Pierre LeBrun noted earlier on, Winnipeg wanted Necas, and that was not happening. So that insinuates the idea that the Carolina Hurricanes just would not have been able to give up a Necas, even though the Elliotte Friedman quote from earlier says that the offer for Carolina was Necas and a D-man, but Winnipeg wouldn't have wanted to do that. So apparently if there was a Necas trade in place, an idea at least for Laine involving Necas, then either side would not have wanted to do it. What in the world? See, this is kind of why the reporting for these trades gets very muddy once in a while, and I'll be honest, I live for the muddiness. How crazy and convoluted these things can get. Yeah, it really does feed into my inner desire as a hockey fan, curiosity speaking wise at least. But going back over to the main idea here for Patrik Laine, because we have indeed spoken about the Carolina Hurricanes before. We made a few videos talking about Patrik Laine and the Blue Jackets, how they were apparently in for Patrik Laine, how the Carolina Hurricanes were in, but apparently they dropped out because the price was too high. I mean, if you're in a position where you're giving up Martin Necas in a top 4D, hypothetically speaking, and they're saying no, my goodness, that's a big, hefty asking price. Now again, the contradiction does exist with the other report that we saw over here from Pierre LeBrun, but again, I don't really know what to believe anymore at this point. Is it likely, though, that Laine gets traded? Because it was noted on the program that it seems to be a lot more likely in practice and in theory than it actually would be in reality because of the stubbornness from Kevin Cheveldayoff to actually make a trade that improves the team itself. All these teams know that Laine is on the block. All these teams know about the complications that are going on with these negotiations and the overall status quo of that relationship. As we said in the previous video, all they have to do is turn on TV, watch TSN Insider Trading for half an hour, and boom, you know that Patrik Laine is in a spot where the agents are saying, yeah, a trade would be mutually beneficial, which we did cover on this channel too, by the way. Despite the fact that they might be so eager when it comes to trying to move Patrik Laine, so aggressive in their calling up other teams and putting him out there on the block and asking what other teams would offer, despite that fact, if they remain super stubborn to the fact that they won't accept what is seemingly a nice offer in Necas on a mid-tier D-man, which is my own speculation for the mid-tier, but yeah, I don't know what they're gonna accept, man. I have no idea. Unless they get themselves a Seth Jones or whatever from the Columbus Blue Jackets, which you know is not going to happen. Unless they get a number one defender like Slavin or whatever from the Hurricanes. I have no idea. And it's why Pierre LeBrun on the most recent episode of That's Hockey on TSN noted that it really is not as simple as it may seem. But now that we've gotten that out of the way, I wanted to talk a little bit more just about that trade proposal itself, because when it comes to Necas and another person, a D-man, for Laine, I saw so many people on different sides of the boat here that it's kind of funny to me just how diversified, I would say, the beliefs are on Hockey Twitter and Hockey Reddit, etc. Because I saw so many people saying, okay, if you're getting Necas for Laine, that's an underpayment. And I saw a lot of other people saying, you know, if you're getting Necas for Laine, that's an overpayment. There were so many people on both sides, especially when you throw in that other defenseman into the mix too, because I think that Martin Necas is just one of the more underrated guys in the league, to be honest. That's kind of why it was reported over here by Pierre LeBrun, apparently, that they would not have wanted to send over a Necas in a deal like that. It's kind of crazy that this guy is so under the radar, and he apparently could be so further down in the depth chart, because hey, you're playing on a squad that already has that Andrei Svechnikov, and that Sebastian Aho, and that Toivo Teravainen, and that you could be overshadowed going into the next generation's worth of Carolina Hurricanes hockey prosperity. So, even though Necas to me is a guy who could become an elite first-line caliber player in this tier, I just don't really know how likely that would be, especially if he's playing behind all these other guys. Sure, having depth doesn't hurt, but in terms of perspective and overall value amongst other people who watch this league who don't necessarily watch Hurricanes games every day, it could come out to bite you in the behind if you're taking a look at Patrik Laine trade rumors and you're saying that Necas isn't enough. I think it's kind of why, in my opinion, it's kind of going to a point where I don't really think Laine is going to be traded. Like, I'm just going to make my prediction right here and now. We'll cover the Laine story as it goes on. We'll talk about other things that are said in the media. Once people come out with new info, we'll discuss that for sure. But just from the stubbornness that they have displayed when it comes to getting themselves a return, the Winnipeg Jets have at least, I don't know if there's actually going to be a return that's going to be sufficient enough and that a team would actually be willing to part with, especially considering Patrik Laine's contract situation, where in a few years he's going to need that extension. He's going to get himself a long-term contract for sure, if not a bridge deal that will take him to unrestricted free agency, and then he's gonna bolt after that to get even more money, something like that. We spoke about that a few days ago as well in a previous video. But with the Carolina Hurricanes, it does kind of make sense, in my opinion, as to the earlier reports we had as to why they dropped out. Because if a Necas idea was straight up rejected by the Jets, and they were in a spot where they didn't want to do it anymore because the asking price was too high, totally makes sense for me, man. I would have really liked to see that Andrei Svechnikov playing alongside of a Patrik Laine on a power play have a first or second line of Teravainen, Laine, Aho for that Finnish connection. My goodness, that would have been incredible. But if the price is just too high and too undesirable from both parties, rejected by both parties, and just straight up not satisfactory, then okay, I guess we're not gonna see that then. I guess we'll wait till the 2022 Winter Olympics, right? Right. Talk to me in the comments what you think about this whole Patrik Laine thing, the Martin Necas trade ideas as well, and how Pierre LeBrun and Elliotte Friedman's reports kind of contradict each other. Talk to me in the comments what you think about those. If you enjoyed this video, that's Ross99. And bye.